Okay, so Maithra, welcome. Thank you for joining us here today at the Deep Learning and Healthcare Summit in London. So you're currently at Google Brain and your work there sounds really interesting. But before we get stuck into that, can you give me an overview of your background and what came first, healthcare or AI and deep learning?
Actually, it was none of these. I started off studying mathematics. Mm-hmm. So as a student in high school, secondary school, I was very interested in mathematics. I took part in some of these Olympiad competitions, mm-hmm. and that led me to go on and do an undergraduate degree in mathematics. Actually, here in the UK, in mm-hmm. Cambridge. And as I was doing this, I realized one topic I was really interested in was the statistics sides of things, because I like the idea that we could have all of this observational data and we somehow want to learn something about this data just from the observations, sort of mathematical questions, like what distribution is it coming from, or even just simpler properties, like what's the average value that we might expect to see. And so this kind of this motivation to look more on the data side of things and a blossoming interest in computer science. So during my undergraduate, I also had the chance to do some basic computer science courses. And then I realized I really wanted to see if these two could kind of be put together. And that led me into machine learning and deep learning and AI.
Wonderful. And going back to Google Brain, can you tell us a bit more about your current work?
Sure. Yeah. So my current work has it's pretty broad. So mm-hmm. I started off being very interested in trying to better understand some of these deep neural network models. So deep neural networks have sort of been extremely successful in a variety of different applications, and they're very powerful and very expressive models, but they're also very complex. So a deep neural network has these neurons that are arranged in layers, and there are many, many parameters connecting all of these neurons together. And the goal of deep learning is to try and find the right values for these parameters. But of course, these parameters are learning something useful, like they're actually learning abstract concepts, and I wanted to better understand what was actually going on with these parameters. How are they converging? What concepts were they learning? And which neurons were learning which kinds of concepts? Mm-hmm. And part of the motivation for doing this was that these models, like I said, are being sort of extremely useful in all kinds of different settings. And one of the settings that I was curious about was the healthcare setting. Mm-hmm. And healthcare is where you want to have more insight into what your model is actually doing. And so I started off by developing these techniques, and now I'm sort of going into the full healthcare side, mm-hmm. looking at how these models are applied there and what kinds of representations and interesting abstractions they pay attention to and need improving on.
So in your presentation, you spoke about direct uncertainty prediction. Can you explain what this is and how you're applying this to healthcare?
Yes, definitely. So direct uncertainty prediction is a way of training a model, in our case, a deep neural network, a convolutional neural network, mm-hmm. to try and predict which patient cases are going to result in a lot of doctor disagreement. Mm-hmm. So what we've seen in a lot of literature, both healthcare and otherwise, is that oftentimes patient cases can have aspects to them that are very confusing for experts. And we'll often have multiple doctors who will look at a single patient case, but then all come to very different conclusions about what the underlying condition for this patient actually is. And so what we develop is a kind of a deep neural network that takes in this patient information and outputs a score. So it can score this patient on whether this is a patient that's likely to need many doctors to look at them, and whether these doctors are going to agree, or whether this is going to be a dead simple case to diagnose. Mm-hmm. And this has a lot of healthcare applications, because using this predictor that we've developed, we can then flag patients that might need additional doctors to look mm-hmm. at them. And the hope is that if there's somebody who's likely to be misdiagnosed, if you just have one expert who looks at them, the hope is that by flagging them, the correct diagnosis will come up on further inspection.
Well, with all that, what challenges are you currently facing in predicting? Okay, I'm gonna do that one again. What challenges are you currently facing in predicting disagreement at Google Brain?
So I'd say this problem is more general than mm-hmm. just Google Brain, which is that there's a huge data challenge. Mm-hmm. So for machine learning in healthcare, especially to train some of these deep learning models, you need large data sets. And for supervised learning, you need large data sets with reliable, accurate labels. And those are very hard to get just mm-hmm. throughout machine learning in general. And without having the accurate labels, it's hard to tell how well your model's performing. So we've tried to address this problem by having a very carefully designed evaluation data set. But what I'd like to see in future is maybe by using some of these direct uncertainty prediction methods, try and see better data labeling and curation processes for the large kinds of deep learning models that are in use today.
So what recent advances in AI have allowed you to make progress in your work?
Definitely a lot of computer vision advances. Mm-hmm. So around 2012 was when we had this first paper that showed us that convolutional neural networks could be used on large images for decent accuracy mm-hmm. and classification. And so we've really built on that work over the entire research community has built on that work in the past mm-hmm. Several years. And so this landmark result has really given us inspiration for developing convolutional neural networks that can process these extremely large images mm-hmm. And output accurate classifications and accurate uncertainty mm-hmm. scores in our case.
It's so interesting how one breakthrough can like change the whole entire industry or many industries in that case.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. So what other areas of healthcare or other industries entirely can benefit from your current research?
So I think for the direct uncertainty prediction mm-hmm. work, I think that could be beneficial in any place where you're trying to collect a large data set for deep learning models. Mm-hmm. So data collection is typically slow, expensive, mm-hmm. and the way it's done is you have some large corpus of data you're interested in. These might be images, they might be speech, so recordings, they might be natural language. Mm-hmm. And what happens is you take this large corpus of data and you send it out to different crowdsource workers. And so these individual human labelers will look at all of these data points and say, oh, I think this is the label or this is the label. And then you get back the results. And unsurprisingly, the results are usually extremely noisy. And so, I mean, one way you can try and solve this problem if you have just unlimited budget is just have more and more people label things, mm-hmm. but that's not realistic at the scale of the data sets we're interested in. And so instead, what you could imagine doing is using machine learning to help collect more data for machine mm-hmm. learning. Which is a happy cycle. And so we can use, say, some of these direct uncertainty models and look at the uncertainty they give to different data points in your corpus and try and allocate labeling effort according to that. So we did some preliminary experiments on that. They're just very preliminary, and I think there's a lot of scope to do this in other domains in our work so far. And we already saw that with the same labeling budget available to us, we could get a 5-10% reduction in the amount of noise we were seeing labels, which is huge. Mm-hmm. And you know, this is just very preliminary. So I think we'll see a lot more of these kinds of methods being used all across all applications of machine learning.
Great. So how are you using AI for good?
So okay, we did
all good.
Okay, so I'd say I'm very passionate about applying machine learning and AI to the healthcare domain mm-hmm. Because I think many places face, say, shortages in doctors mm-hmm. or overworked doctors yeah. or even don't have access to a doctor. So mm-hmm. so there are places, rural places that are very isolated and where you can't just go see a specialist that yeah. easily. And so they all deserve the right to yeah. to have better healthcare and
better access
and better it. Access mm-hmm. exactly. And by developing these technologies, you're enabling these people to hopefully have a much better quality of life than you would otherwise.
Definitely, yes. So have you faced any challenges being a woman working in AI?
Definitely, I wish there were more in the field.
Yeah, definitely.
But I'm optimistic about that too. So mm-hmm. I've been a co-organizer for many events for women in machine learning. Mm-hmm. In fact, there's an entire organization called Women in Machine Learning, yeah. and they have a sort of flagship workshop that mm-hmm. happens in neural information processing systems, which mm-hmm. is sort of a huge conference for AI and machine learning every mm-hmm. December. And so one thing I have seen, which is very exciting, is like the number of women in the field has consistently mm-hmm. increased
growing, yeah.
with every passing year. So that's mm-hmm. very exciting to see. I think I'd like to see I'd like to see more women in sort of maybe at the interface of industry and research. Mm-hmm. I feel like I've seen less women there, and it'd be very exciting to see more of that. Mm-hmm. I think diversity is really important for having new perspectives on problems or even identifying new problems that perhaps you can't, you wouldn't immediately think of. Mm-hmm. So that's my hopes for the future, but I'm also optimistic that we'll get there.
So what kind of advice would you have to someone who would be newly starting out in AI or why they should pursue a career in this?
Yeah, so it's a very exciting field. Mm-hmm. So that would be my recommendation for why you should pursue it. As to advice, I'd say AI is a huge field, mm-hmm. and you should think about how you want to be involved with AI. That's a big part of the question. So, of course, there's a lot of people doing research on it, and if you're interested in the research side, then what you should do is look at papers that have come out recently that people have been very excited about. There are lots of online forums for discussing discussing some of these papers. Reddit machine learning is actually a pretty good source of papers. Twitter is actually a pretty good
Social media is great for this.
Social media is actually good for paper recommendations. Mm-hmm. And there are a couple of other projects. There's a project called Archive Sanity that someone called Andre Karpathy came up with, which is a fantastic recommendation system for different, for useful and interesting machine learning papers. So look at all of these resources, see what papers seem interesting, read them through, and definitely practice implementing them. I think being able to implement things confidently and successfully is also a big part of being able to do research in AI, because you need to be able to run experiments and probably run a lot of experiments.
Trial and error.
Exactly. Yeah. There is a lot of trial and error. So so you have to feel comfortable doing that. So that would be my advice for people wanting to get into the research side of AI. For kind of the research and industry intersection, I mean, if there's a specific application you're excited about, then definitely you should look to see, you know, what companies, like established companies, are doing in that space, what maybe new companies are excited about in that space, whether there's research that applies to that direction. That would be some ways to blend the application and research parts of AI.
Amazing. So what's next for you in your work?
What's next for me? I'm very excited about pushing forward the AI, machine learning, and healthcare aspects. So I'd like to do more work on developing interpretability methods for these models and actually try and see if we can gain scientific insights on healthcare using some of these techniques. I'd also like to push some of the algorithms and methodology we're developing for healthcare into hopefully full-fledged clinical settings and see how they perform. So some things along those lines.
So where can we keep up to date with you? Do you have a Twitter or website so we can check out what you've been up to?
I do have a Twitter. That's for keeping up with all the papers. So I have a website. That's MaithraRaghu.com. And my Twitter is Maithra_Raghu. So I usually post about things I'm up to there.
That's great. Well, everyone better check it out and we'll see what you're up to.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you so much. Thanks.